Howdy, y'all. Bill Luciano. I have the sweet ears to hear news coming at you. The final part of Fiona Barnett's The Candy Girl. Happy Halloween. Love you. Pray for you always. Please share with somebody you know. Yeah, I don't want to have to revisit that. Just go from here. Whoops. Sorry, y'all. Bill Luciano, eyes to see, ears to hear news coming at you. Love you. Pray for you always. Happy Halloween. Please share with somebody you know.
Now, these people, the whole point behind doing the, having the woman not drugged and not hypnotized is to pump as much adrenaline through her blood as possible.
Adrenochrome.
Because people are addicted to adrenaline. And when they drink the blood, you know, it's, you know, the baby's blood. You know, the baby's in distress, so it passes on somehow to the kid. And that's why they, you know, have this sort of situation going on. And the end, I was over here and a bloody orgy broke out and everyone started having sex. They're sexually aroused by this stuff. You've got to understand that they are sexually aroused by this crap.
Yeah, you guys have been with the lines long enough. Sorry.
And Kim Beazley Sr. was down here and I was there. And he came down and he picked up a head of one of the kids that had dark hair. And I'm standing here and Beazley picks up this head and he shoves it in my face like this. And there's this decapitated head in my face. And he says, take and eat. And he made me take a bite out of the face. And then everyone just had an orgy. It was just disgusting. And most vile thing you've ever seen in your life. And that's Bathurst U.
3 times I've had to flee, leave everything behind 3 times. One, okay, but 3 times.
What I do have to offer is the, I can share what how I got out.
Yeah.
That's all I've got.
Deep down, she wants to enjoy life, I think. But, you know, she finds it very hard.
In no way did it change Mum's personality, but how do I put it? Grandma phrased it very well. So she could place blame where blame is due.
It's so complex. If I want to put it in, apply it, you know, to behaviour. It's so complex because I always thought that I was rational and analytical, you know, and that you could sort of make sense of things. Well, sometimes you can't. You know, it's outside those boundaries.
The Great Hall at Sydney University is where I witnessed the most heinous human sacrifice of all time and the most difficult one to process and talk about in therapy. And that is the flaying of a boy who was about 5, a little blonde boy, Anthony Kidman, and 4 other men. We're dressed in multicoloured robes according to the pentagram sort of symbol that I suppose captured the inner Sydney diocese that Kidman led, his coven, and so there were multicoloured robes that I've drawn. I was...
Well, if it's quite related young, to Nicole Kidman.
I tried to stop the ritual as soon as I realised what was going on and what they were about to do to this child. They crucified him and flayed his skin and pinned it back. And then they strung him up over. Once they'd done it, they did it to him alive. Once they'd finished that, they strung him up over the stage of the Great Hall. Nicole Kidman was sitting down to the front.
Yes, she was.
to look at, to the left as you look at the stage. I was sitting more to the back right, and I ran up and tried to stop them, and Bruce Spence put his big boot on my, put his foot on my neck to stop me. And he just laughed at me, and everyone laughed at me, screaming and carrying on, trying to stop what they were doing. And, quite a number of university staff are involved in Sydney Uni chapter, I suppose, of the Order, which was run by Kidman. And Leonis Petruscus was a member of this particular coven at one stage, and he was at Sydney University around the same time as Anthony Kidman. So there's lots of prominent coven members who have gone through Sydney University. It's a very dark place, and I would not allow my children to attend here, even on scholarship. I also remember being taken into the room on an upper floor of the chemistry lecturer's room, and they did something to me there, and it was overlooking the city, and I was also taken into a sort of a medical basement area where I was subjected to some unethical practices, and Hope Michelson was involved in that. She's someone I went to uni with later on at Bond University. When I was young, I remember her clearly, dressed in a white robe and assisting a dentist who had used to be, I think he formerly worked at Auschwitz.
And it allowed me to sit there and be an observer to my own deprogramming process, which is phenomenal. You know, like that false military, he's a really military programmer and reprogrammer in Adelaide.
Thompson.
Yeah, that evil mongrel, David Thompson. He couldn't believe it. He said, are you co-conscious? Are you co-conscious for all this when you're talking? Because I went through the process and I described everything as requested. I just answered questions. He said, are you co-conscious? I said, well, yeah. We've always been co-conscious. There's been no Sybil, an amnesia for what we just talked about. And that was my saving.
I could ignore it and, live for the moment, as you say, but I know I couldn't sleep at night.
So this is a very memorable church. I remember this. I came here with Veronica. The place was packed. And I witnessed a heck of a ceremony. And Veronica was the grand dame. And she was my mentor. And I really liked her a lot. Red-headed lady. She had something to do with... some sort of girls' school or something like that. And I saw her ritually sacrificed here in front of all the dignitaries. The head being up this end on that image is no accident. That's the way you face on an altar when you ritually sacrifice someone. The head's always up this end. And it's called the left-handed path, so they always use the left hand and they start with the upper chest area
and
she
down.
Was dying. I actually was so distraught I collapsed up behind this side of the altar, and everybody thought, oh, that was great, because it's a sign of affection and that we had a proper bond. I succeeded her as grand dame, and this is distressing. Left them with no one that they'd trained up in time to succeed the grand dame position. Veronica actually died quite young, and it was her choice. She had had a gutful and she wanted out, and she didn't know how else to get out. Think of a song you can check out any time you like, but you can never leave. She chose to check out. It's the only way out for her. And she was a really nice person. I think she was connected to St. Sophia College, but I can't remember well enough. I know she had some role to do with girls' school or a girls' dorm. At the end, I had to compose myself, despite the fact she was laying there dead, blood everywhere. I had to compose myself. I had no choice. And they stuck some robe on me and something on my head. I don't know. Anyway, this is really, really, really upsetting.
That's all. So this is Anglican, and you've got another eagle. It's just another heavy occult symbol. About 11, around the time that Queen Elizabeth came to declare Bankstown City. I just remember children connected with like a silver cord or silver cord and around their necks and a row of children. That's all I remember. I don't remember anything else. Rose. The rose is very important to Church of England covens. Serpent entwined around a pole. I mean, once again, what the hell's an eagle got to do with the Bible? Nothing.
This is 16 William Edward Street, Longville, in sort of North Sydney. This is Anthony Kidman's old house. I was brought here when I was 14. I was dropped off by Leonis Petruscus. It was my birthday, and there was, well, I think it was around my birthday, I think it was, and there was a post-production party for John Bell's play, and this house was, the back room overlooking the pool was full of actors and, you know, producers, directors, you know, whatever, and theatre people, John Bell. Bruce Spence was here. I'm pretty sure Bruce Spence answered the door. I remembered the house was two-storey at the back and kind of one-storey at the front. I remembered it was Federation style. And I remembered the back room and I remember the pool. I saw people taking what I think was cocaine in the back room near the pool in the lounge area. People were kind of in costume. There was all different, I don't know if it was a fancy dress party. I really can't remember exactly what everyone was wearing, but I know there was a lot of famous actors there. After everybody had gone home, I was left alone with John Bell and Anthony Kidman, and I remember being in the back lounge room that opens up onto the pool area, and I was assaulted in the lounge room area by Kidman and Bell, and I watched them engage in homosexual sex there. Then I was taken out into the pool, and I was thrown in the pool naked, and Kidman got in the pool as well, and he held my... We were at the far end of the pool in line with the back gate, and I was facing out of the pool. I was facing John Bell, who was acting like an idiot, like doing a monkey dance, and he had a mask on his face. And he was naked, and I was being held very painfully. Anthony Kidman was in the pool locking my elbows together and pulling my shoulders back, so it was like a type of jiu-jitsu type hold, you know, something, it would be something you learn in martial arts, and it was very painful. And while he did this, John Bell would be dancing like a monkey, and every now and then, and he'd be chanting some sort of song, and then every now and then he just stomped on my head as he said certain words in the... like a poem, like a rhyme, and he'd
stomp on my head and hold me under, like force me under, and I nearly drowned. And, you know, then I'd come up again, I'd be coughing, spluttering and crying and vomiting water, and then it'll happen again and again. It happened over and over, and I don't remember what happened after that, except I woke up the next day tied to a chair in what looked like a basement. It was very cold and cement-like, and I remember light filtering down through a doorway, but it was like a ladder or a very steep stairway to upstairs, and I was seated in a chair, naked, tied to a chair, and Kidman was smacking me over the head really hard. He was physically assaulting me, and he was screaming at me, "Do you remember now? Do you remember now?" And meanwhile, Nicole Kidman, his daughter, had her arms crossed, and she was leaning against a wall and sneering at me in contempt, with contempt. She didn't like me at all. She never liked me. Associated with her quite a bit throughout our childhoods, and she always treated me terribly. Mrs. Kidman washed and dried my clothes, and I was dressed, and Dr. Mark came and picked me up.
I didn't know that about the clothes, Mrs. Kidman. No.
Did you just remember that then?
What I believe has been coming out in the Royal Commission against child abuse is proving that this is not isolated. You know, this might be unique in her story, but across the board it's not isolated. In fact, it's more prevalent than not.
So I hear you were abused as a child. You want to tell us about that in 7 years?
Yeah, oh, shit.
All right, y'all. So that's the end of it. Wow, huh? What a trip.
The Earth is billions of years old, and in all this time has seen a lot.
Bill Luciano, I don't know what else to say. I really don't. Maybe that if there's any parents out there who are into trick-or-treating or celebrate the holiday, whether you're a church or not, if you're an elder in God's word, if you're a meat lover, you should know about these things, and you should not be celebrating it. So if anything, let it be that. I love you. Bill Luciano. Eyes to see, ears to hear news coming at you. Love you. Pray for you always. Coming at you documentary style. Please share with somebody you know.